The internet is filled with an endless supply of images, so why aren't we using all of this data to train our models? Well, typically, to train a deep learning model, we need both the images and their corresponding labels. But hold on, do we really need these labels? Couldn't we teach the models directly on the images without any description? Let's find out. In traditional machine learning, we usually have a data set where each example has a label, say an image of a dog paired with the label dog. Our algorithm or model learns by comparing its predictions with these labels and adjusting its parameters based on how well it performed. After some time of being wrong and some optimization, our model will eventually predict the labels correctly. But what happens if we don't have labeled data? Can we still teach a machine to learn something useful? Well, the answer is yes, we actually can. For example, if I show you enough images of dogs and cats, you can figure out that they're different, even without knowing their names. This approach of finding patterns without explicit labels is called unsupervised learning, a technique used in algorithms like k-means or TSNE, which we covered in a previous video. While supervised and unsupervised learning are nice, there's another approach that's somewhere in between, called self-supervised learning. In self-supervised learning, we create a pretext task from the data itself, and this task should not require any additional labels to evaluate the model's performance. By training the model on this fake task, we hope that it will learn some useful representations of the data that we can use later for our real problem. Why do we need self-supervised learning when we already have supervised learning? Well, here's the thing. Having a perfectly labeled dataset is actually quite rare, and creating one from scratch can be extremely expensive. Imagine a human manually labeling every data point, thousands, maybe even millions of images. That takes an enormous amount of time and resources. And the advantages of self-supervised learning go beyond just solving the labeling issue. For example, say you've trained a complex neural network for a segmentation task. But now you would like to reuse this network on another problem, for instance, image restoration. With supervised learning, there's no guarantee the representations learned for segmentation will be useful for restoration. However, with self-supervised learning, the whole point is to learn versatile general-purpose representations. Speaking of learning good representations, have you ever wondered how large language models understand the world they interact with? Well, you're in luck because this video is sponsored by Brilliant. Brilliant is an interactive learning platform that lets you dive deep into topics like math, data analysis, programming, and now even AI through hands-on problem-solving lessons. Watching YouTube videos is great for learning, but it's mostly passive, and let's face it, that's not the most effective way to master complex topics. Brilliant is designed to make learning active and engaging with carefully crafted interactive lessons. They recently added a course on how large language models work, and it's a perfect intro if, like me, you're curious about natural language processing, but don't know where to start. If you want to try out Brilliant for free for 30 days, head over to brilliant.org/deepier, scan the QR code on screen, or just click on the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Back to the topic, as we said with self-supervised learning, the model has learned pretty good general purpose representations, so it's already pretty good at handling various downstream tasks right out of the gate. And if you need even better performance for a specific task, fine-tuning the model is far easier than starting the training from scratch. Put simply, contrastive learning is a family of self-supervised learning methods that help models learn meaningful representations from data, even when we don't have labels. The key idea is pretty intuitive. Images that show similar objects should have similar representations in the model's representation space, while images that are different should be represented in a way that makes them far apart. Think of it this way. Imagine we have images of a cat and a dog. In the latent space of the neural network, two images of the same dog should be close together, even if they're taken from different angles or under different lighting. And of course, the image of the cat should be farther away from the images of the dog, because they represent two different things. This general idea of clustering similar things together in the latent space isn't new. But what makes contrastive learning unique is how it explicitly enforces these relationships during training through a special loss function. This loss function essentially pulls together representations of similar objects and at the same time pushes apart those of dissimilar objects. So what exactly is this special loss function and how does it work? Well, there are several loss functions that can help us achieve the goal of separating similar and dissimilar data points. But let's start by focusing on what's commonly referred to as the contrastive loss. The contrastive loss takes a pair of data points as input, along with a parameter called the margin, denoted by M. It behaves differently depending on whether the pair is positive or negative. If the pair is positive, this means that the two points are supposed to be similar, so we want to minimize the distance between them. In this case, the loss is simply the squared distance between the two points. If the pair is negative, we want to push the points apart until their distance reaches the margin M. So if their distance is smaller than the margin, the loss is the difference between the margin and the current distance. However, if the distance is already greater than the margin, the loss is zero, since the points are far enough apart. This means that we can just take the difference between D and M when it is positive and zero otherwise. By combining these two cases into a single formula, we get the final expression for the contrastive loss, which handles both positive and negative pairs. Indeed, when we have a positive pair, Y is equal to zero, and by minimizing the loss, we get the points closer together. And when we have a negative pair, Y is equal to 1, and the loss will push the points apart until they reach the margin. Another well-known type of contrastive loss is the triplet loss. It was popularized by the FaceNet paper, which focused on facial recognition and achieved an impressive 30% reduction in error rate compared to other state-of-the-art methods at the time. As the name suggests, the triplet loss works with triplets of data, instead of the pairs we saw in the regular contrastive loss. These triplets consist of three key points: an anchor, a positive, which is similar to the anchor, and a negative, which is dissimilar. The goal of the triplet loss is to ensure that the distance between the anchor and the negative is at least as big as the distance between the anchor and the positive, plus a safety margin that we note as M. Here you can see that this condition is satisfied since the negative is far beyond the margin. This means that in this case the loss will be zero, which is not very useful to train the network. In this new configuration, the negative is actually closer to the anchor than the positive. So the loss should push the network to bring the positive closer to the anchor and the negative further away. The condition that the loss function should impose can be written as follows. This means that if this condition is not satisfied, the loss function should minimize this quantity. In addition, we avoid negative values as it does not really make sense to optimize further once the condition is satisfied. So here we have the final expression of the triplet loss, at least for one triplet of data. The total loss is the sum of these triplet losses across all triplets in the dataset. For both contrastive loss and triplet loss, there are situations where the loss is zero and therefore doesn't provide a meaningful signal for training the network. Take the contrastive loss, for example. If two negative data points are already far apart, beyond the margin M, the loss becomes zero, and the model doesn't learn anything new from this pair. Similarly, if two points from a positive pair are already closer than the margin M, the loss is also zero. In both cases, the network has no incentive to adjust its weights and improve its representation. And the same principle applies to the triplet loss. If the negative example is already farther from the anchor than the positive, the loss will again be zero. Essentially, the model is doing its job well enough that there's nothing more to learn from these particular samples. To effectively train the network, we need to focus on hard examples. These are cases where the model still struggles, for instance, a negative very close to the anchor. Let's say we have two classes, cats and dogs. Here, the negative instance is very different from the anchor, but we can actually choose some cat images that resemble dogs. For example, this image will be much harder for the model to differentiate from the anchor, and the two images will be closer in the model's representation space. By focusing on these challenging cases, the network gets a stronger learning signal. This process of finding and using hard examples is called hard example mining, and it has been an important area of research for some years. Now that we have a solid grasp of how contrastive learning works, let's see how these ideas were applied in SimCLR. SimCLR, which stands for a simple framework for contrastive learning, was introduced in 2020 by a team at Google led by none other than Jeffrey Hinton. If you haven't heard of Hinton, he's one of the pioneers of AI, often called one of the godfathers of deep learning. Ah, and he recently won a Nobel Prize in Physics, in case you did not see the news. So what exactly is this simple framework that quickly became a reference in the world of self-supervised learning? As we've seen, the loss function is often the key component in contrastive learning methods. In SimCLR, the authors opted for the info-NCE loss, which generalizes the previous losses we've seen in the video. As you can see, the loss reads a little bit differently and is defined in terms of probabilities rather than distances. The main difference is that instead of just comparing an anchor with one positive and one negative, the info-NCE loss uses one positive pair and many negative pairs. This enables us to lessen the need for hard example mining. We simply take a lot of negatives, and hopefully some of them will provide some signal to the network. And this not only simplifies the training process, but also helps the model learn more robust representations from the data. But how are the positive and negative pairs actually created? In SimCLR, contrastive pairs are created using data augmentation. First, a random crop is applied to the original image, followed by random color distortion that alters brightness, contrast, saturation, and hue. These transformations produce two distinct views of the same image, forming the positive pair. Despite their visual differences, both views still represent the same object, so the model learns to generate similar representations for them. For the negative pairs, SimCLR selects another image from the same batch and applies the same augmentation process. This process is repeated for all other images in the batch, creating one positive pair and many negative pairs for each anchor image. Because negatives are sampled from within the batch, SimCLR requires very large batch sizes. While most models use batches of 64 to 256 images, SimCLR takes this further, working with massive batch sizes of 4,096 or even 8,192 images. SimCLR delivers outstanding performance, almost surpassing fully supervised models. For instance, when tested on ImageNet classification, SimCLR achieves a top 1 accuracy of 76%, very close to the performances achieved with a supervised ResNet 50, all while using self-supervised learning, without any labeled data. Even more impressive, when fine-tuned on just 1% of ImageNet labels, SimCLR reaches an 86% top 5 accuracy, outperforming fully supervised models like AlexNet, which relies on 100 times more labeled data. As we saw previously, a key factor behind SimCLR's success is its use of large batch sizes. Bigger batches provide more negative examples, which are crucial for learning strong representations. Here you can see the analysis of the influence of the batch size on the final classification performances. The final top 1 accuracy improves by about 3% when using a batch size of 2048 compared to 256, and convergence happens much faster with the larger batches. This also shows that we can still achieve relatively good performances even with a regular batch size. So to wrap things up, we've seen that it's definitely possible to learn without labels thanks to self-supervised learning, a clever middle ground between supervised and unsupervised learning. Among self-supervised methods, contrastive learning has shown promising performances by enforcing that similar data points have similar latent representations, using loss functions that operate directly in the representation space. SimCLR applies these ideas and achieves performance levels that come close to fully supervised learning. However, the catch is the need for very large batch sizes, which makes scaling a real challenge. In the next video, we'll explore another approach to self-supervised learning called bootstrap your own latent, which takes things even further by eliminating the need for negative pairs altogether. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you found this helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you in the next one.